Good morning. It's good to be together. Amen. It's encouraging to be together in worship. I look around. I know many of you have come from all different places, different activities this weekend. Some have been with family that are ill. Some have been alone and need to be with family here. We have some prayer concerns in our family, church family, I mean, that are important. And it's just good to gather and remind each other of who we are in Christ. Amen. And even in days like this, the church, I hope you believe this with all your heart, that it's hard not to sing with joy. Let's stand up and sing this morning. How can I keep from singing? Father God, thank you for bringing us together. Thank you for the beauty of your truth and mercy. Lord, you forgive. With you there is much forgiveness, and we are the people who come to you needing that. You love. You start love. You create. You make. You build and you redeem. And Father, you are the refuge we run to, the rock we cling to, the friend, our Father. And you've made us family with an inheritance, and we're grateful to you. And Lord, help us to be so filled with that truth that we live in this world and bear fruit. Help our worship sing out that truth. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. Here is the word from 1 Peter 1, the chapter we're studying today. May it bless you and call us all to worship. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. You can build a life on that truth, amen? And we worship from that truth. Let's continue in our worship, singing out the name of Jesus, because there is a name, and that name has power.
There is a name who reigns without contention, whose power can't be questioned or contained.
Beautiful.
With humble faith, he rules the earth and heaven. His glory knows no measure or refrain. And it's bursting past the borderlines of space. Jesus, enthroned upon the praises of our the margins, calling sons and daughters back to him. As he says, we can hear the roar of heaven as prodigals are coming home again. Oh, the triumph of his name will never end. Enthroned upon the praises of our hearts. Jesus, you're the King and you're the center of it all. For every eye will see, every heart will know, there is no name above the name of Jesus. Death could not hold him down, no grave could keep him bound. All sin and sickness bow to the name of Jesus. For every eye will see, and every heart will know, there is no name above. Could keep him bound, all sin and sickness bound to the name of Jesus, enthroned upon the praises of our hearts. Jesus, you're the King.
Our call to confess sin this morning is in Hebrews, and it's instruction for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. I love the way this was in the Amplified. I'm just going to read you just a little bit of it. It says, look away from all that distract you from Jesus, who is the source of our faith. You know, distraction in my life causes a lot of weariness and frustration. And there's so much distraction today, isn't there? If you feel like you're struggling with undivided attention this morning, if there's anything distracting you from God or keeping you from growing in your faith or time with the Lord, when we go to our silent prayer, just take that time to ask God to reveal what those distractions are to you and turn those over to Him. Will you pray with me silently, please? Lord, I just pray that you will forgive us this morning when we allow distractions and entanglements of this world to block out the light of your word. Help us to always keep our focus on you, the author and perfecter of our faith. Thank you for your ultimate sacrifice of your son on the cross. And we love you, Lord. In your precious name, I pray these things. Amen.
And we have such a wonderful and gracious God who are assured in his word. I'll be the leader and you be the people.
Amen.
I have been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me.
If anyone is in Christ,
we don't have the people. We don't have people.
We'll be your people.
We'll be your people. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone. The new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. Amen.
This time we'll have Josh Simons come forward. Josh will lead us in our children's time. Thank you, Josh. This is a big week because kids are heading into VBS, too, later this week.
There we are. As you can see, I brought a couple of ruffians up with me. So a couple of things to go over first before we get into our Family Five time is VBS is this week. So today from 11:30 to 1 o'clock, come by and pick up your packets. It has everything you need in them, all the instructions, all of the supplies, and then videos will be available on the website and should go out on Facebook as well so you can access those. So have a lot of fun this week. And then come back next week, and this is not just for those in VBS. This is for everyone from 0 to 99, or do we have any hundreds?
Yes.
Everyone's welcome for prizes and treats next Sunday from 11:30 to 1 o'clock as well. And everything's outside so we can be spread out and have safe distance and all that. But you are all invited to join us and celebrate the fun that the kids have had. There's a challenge as part of the VBS, so families have these challenges they can do. They get points that way, and then when their points are, they can come and get prizes for those points. Another thing about next week is July 19th was supposed to be our target for opening Children's Church in the nursery. But with everything that's going on and still just wanting to keep everyone safe, including our kids and our littlest ones and all the people that work with them, we're going to postpone opening Children's Church and the nursery at least through July. So the earliest we would open that would be up August 2nd, and we'll just again, keep monitoring the situation, but more importantly, we just want to make sure everyone is safe, and don't want to put people in uncomfortable positions if they're not ready. So, okay, so now I've got my girls up here, and if we can get up the Bible verse, there we go. So James 2:2-4 says, suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and suppose a, well, hold on. Let's act this out. This will be better than, we can instead of reading it, we'll get to act this out. Okay, so Ruth, come over here. This is my daughter, Ruth, my oldest. She's going to be poor. And this is my youngest, Rose, and she's going to be rich. And you guys are going to help me. I'm going to pull an item out of the box, and you have to tell me who should put it on, okay? And you have to put it on. You have to put it on. Okay. I have to tell her that because she won't participate. Okay. All right, so... Oh, here's a nice, like, suit coat. Okay, so who would that... Would that be the rich or the poor? Rich. Yeah, there you go. All right, there you go. Get that on. Come on, come on. Okay, and what else we got? Oh, yes. Yes. Here's an old, dirty, torn-up shirt. Who would this go to? The poor. Yeah, there you go. Get that on. You can put it on over it. It's okay. It'll fit. It's okay. Go ahead. Go ahead. All right. Let's see. Oh, here we go. A nice big ring. Who would that go to? There we go. Yeah, get that on. Oh, very fancy. Let's see. Oh, here's a dingy old hat. It looks like an old work hat or something. Who would this go to? Poor. There we go. Oh, man, you're looking good. All right. Ooh, stack of cash. Who's that going to? The rich. Oh, man, here's some old dirty shoes. You don't have to put those on. We'll just set those there. It would take you too long. Okay. Now, here's how I'm going to behave. I'm going to look at this person and go, ooh, look at that nice suit and the ring and the money. I'm going to kind of, why don't you just go sit down over there? Just go sit down.
Aww.
Yeah, yeah. You're all dirty and poor and But you, I want to be friends with you. Yeah. Well, okay, so audience participation time now. If I'm doing the right thing, give me a big yay. If I'm doing the wrong thing, go ahead and boo me. Okay, all right, all right, all right. Okay, come up here. So let's focus on one of the next verse, which... Or not. There we go. My brothers and sisters, you are believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, so treat everyone the same. And here's the thing. Here's the Jesus we believe in. So I need you to come over here. Why'd you take the hat off? You didn't have permission to do that. Come over here. Because Jesus spread out his arms on the cross around all... Because he loves everyone. All were sinners. He died for all, and he loves all people the same, and he calls us to treat everyone the same as well. All right, I got one last question, audience participation. If you believe that these girls should wear this for the rest of the service, give me a big yay. Yay! Okay, there you go. Excellent. Awesome. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us all the same, no matter who we are, no matter what we have done. Your sins covered, or your death on the cross covered all of our sins, no matter who we are. Thank you for loving us the same. And let us remember that and show others that we have that faith in a Lord that treats all the same and treat others the same as well. And they can see that love of you in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Such a good word. And in a time where there's a challenge to leadership, a vacuum perhaps there, God's word will always be a lamp. Let's stand and sing.
To my feet. and alive unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and I think I've lost my way, you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto
morning. It is great to be with you all and have you all here who are here, who can be here, and those of you who are watching on YouTube or Facebook. We want to continue to just encourage you that you are as much a part of the church as any of us who are gathered here. We are grateful that you are with us and are worshiping with us, and we want to do whatever we can to honor and bless you. And for those of us who are here, thank you for, we're recommending that you wear a mask as much as possible, and recommending that you keep distance between yourselves so that we just continue to maintain safety for everybody who chooses to come or who chooses to stay away. I have an announcement. I think there's an announcement slide for serving our students. We've collected all the stuff that we were going to collect, but if you would like to register, you see the way to do it. If you know a family or if your family would like to register for this, this is coming up this Saturday, and it is a curbside pickup. It is something that you basically drive up and receive the things that they give you. But a great ministry of our church, great ministry of our churches around the area. Okay, thanks for that. Also, I wanted to share with you. No, I'm not texting my wife. I'm passing on a text from Greg and Tammy and Maggie and Greta, who are now in Hong Kong. Maybe watching, as far as we know, or maybe later are watching. If you guys are watching, awesome. So glad that you guys are there and doing okay. She says, we're just finishing day two of quarantine. They have to quarantine for 2 weeks, or 10 days or 2 weeks, I think. Things have been good. Three staff here at the school have been great and welcoming. Thank you for the prayers. So they are there. We're glad that they are there. And you know what? Just continue to pray for them. As I mentioned last week, we now have their beloved, blessed dog, Abe. So every time I look at Abe, I pray for the Coles. It's pretty neat. I also want to let you know that Sherry Albrandt is at Menorah Hospital recovering, and Pat Briley is at KU Med Center with double pneumonia, so we need to lift her up in prayer. Oh, glad you're watching also, Pat. And Janet Offit has been moved to a hospital in Kansas City, Kansas, where she is continuing to recover, so we want to pray for her. There's a whole list of people that we want to lift up, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, before we do that, I also want to say congratulations to Dino and Robin Mata on the birth of their granddaughter, Juliet Isabel, who was born to Joshua and Gwyneth Mata of San Francisco, California. So praise the Lord for that. Let's pray. Lord, I have to admit, I love that song, Thy Word. It is such a joy to sing that to you, knowing that you have blessed us in such a way with the scriptures that touch our hearts. And we pray, Lord, that as Pastor Kirk comes this morning, that you would open up your word through him to us, so that we might be guided by it. We know that your spirit guides us. We know that Jesus guides us. And we pray that as we hear from your word today, that you would transform us. You would help us to see that there are things in this world that we need to stay clear of. We need to avoid for the betterment of ourselves and others. And Lord, that there are things that we need to do. You have provided so many resources for us. And there are things that we can do to apply ourselves so that we are walking with you and pursuing you to the best of our ability. And we thank you, Lord, that you, by your Holy Spirit, you pursue us. And for those of us who have given our hearts to you and have trusted ourselves to you, we are so grateful that you didn't give up on us. We think of Peter, that we are going through these letters now, and you didn't give up on Peter. And Lord, you transformed him into a leader in your church and someone who not only loved you but gave his life and his leadership skills and his heart to the people around him. We thank you for his example. And we thank you for all the examples in your word and also all around us and the Christians who are living their lives. And we think of Christians in far places, distant places, that are suffering on your behalf, just like Paul suffered on your behalf. And we pray, Lord, that you would help them not be ashamed of you, because there is no shame in their suffering. They are doing it for you. And we pray, Lord, that their lives would count. We pray that our lives would count. We want to make our lives count for you and for your kingdom. May you use us in powerful ways in the lives of people around us, even though we are sheltering at home. Still, many of us are unable to get out. We pray that you would hear our prayers and that you would move us to write to people through emails or texts or whatever ways. Generate that spirit in us so that we can be generous with other people. And Father, for those who are struggling right now in health issues, we want to lift them up today. We pray for Sherry Albrandt as she continues to recover. And we pray for Pat Briley as she has this double pneumonia and ask that you would bring healing to her. We also lift up Janet Offit at the hospital as well. And in the process of recovering from a long period of recovery. We lift up Charlie Brink to you and Jackie Brewer. We continue to pray for Pam Bryant, and pray that you would provide her a kidney. We pray for Billy Fretz and Scott Hines, and we lift up Sheila Majors and Jenny Paulson, and we pray for Peggy Willows and Dax Allen. Father, we lift up Virginia Ayers and Tom Balch and Kirk Blaine and Katie Hermrick. We continue to pray for Pam Heyer and Stevie Holderman and Don Carnes and Joan McComb and Kelly McKinney and Laura Park and Gary Patillo and Rosemary Wolf. Father, we pray that you would help the virus to end and that fewer people would get ill and nobody would die from this, Lord. And we pray for all the division in our country as well, that you would help us come together and especially come together in Christ. Lord, for those who have lost loved ones, Julie Zoller lost her father, Alvin Brunkhart, and the Cummings family lost Ken, we lift them up to you and pray your comfort and solace and kindness and mercy to them at this time. And we celebrate, Lord, with Dino and Robin at the birth of their granddaughter, Juliet, and with Joshua and Gwyneth as well, and pray your blessing on that child, and bless her as she grows. We ask, Lord, that you would, again, turn our attention to not just the reading of your word, but the preaching of your word and the living out of your word. That's the kind of community that we want to be. We want to be people who are transformed and changed by you and take your message to a world that needs to hear it. In the name of Jesus, we pray these things. Our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Brad. Well, we're eating steak today in our word. And if you're a vegetarian, protein smoothie, whatever it is, to remind you that what we're going to do today is look at really powerful, healthy, nourishing things for the believer. We're in 1 Peter. And Peter begins the chapter. Brad did such a good introduction that we're just going to jump right into the word now. First things first for Peter is we need to know who Peter is. And then Peter gets right to telling us who the believer is. And so knowing your identity really is, I want to say basic, but it's also the deepest understanding of who we are in Christ. So who Peter is, here's how the letter begins. Simeon Peter, of course, Simon was his given name, but Peter was the name Jesus gave him. And it means rock, rocky. In all of its aspects, I like this about Jesus. He's a nickname giver, right? He's the guy who put his arm around you. And, right, I tell you to have a little Clint Eastwood in your Jesus, you know, because he's tough, he's strong. There's bad parts of Clint Eastwood, just the good parts. And also have a little John Candy or Chris Farley, just the good parts. The Jesus who laughed, amen, who was a hail fellow, well met. And if he saw you with all good, not a bad nickname giver, a good nickname giver. But part of what the nickname means is that Peter was rocky. He would be, his faith would be a rock the church would build on. But he would also have a rocky relationship with that. Sometimes he would act out of his faith and sometimes out of his fear, as Brad talked about last week. So giving him this name encourages all of us who understand what that's like. So the letter begins. This is who it's from. Simon Peter. Simon, rocky, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Apostle means one sent, but it also refers to those disciples who were actually with Jesus, who met him. They were the unique eyewitnesses, and they were sent by command of Jesus. So that's who Peter is. He's an apostle of Jesus Christ. The rest of the letter starts to tell us who we are. to God's elect. There's an important phrase. To be God's elect means to be chosen, to be secure by virtue of believing in Jesus' death for sin, his blood sacrifice. If you believe in Jesus' sacrifice on the cross to pay your penalty for sin, you are elect. Isn't that interesting? Does your belief cause your election? No. It confirms it. The work of Jesus brings about all the necessary conditions, but you have to participate in it. You have to take office. Now, this status is sure and certain in those who by faith believe on Jesus for salvation. So I have to ask you, we know who Peter is. He's writing this letter. Are you the elect? Do you have your faith in Jesus? If so, then this is you. And it gets better. To God's elect exiles, here's a qualifier. You are the elect and you're also exiled. You're not home. Ostensibly, he's writing this to people in the areas of Asia Minor. But we're reading the mail. In other words, if I go backwards, this letter is to you if you're God's elect. If not, you're reading someone else's mail. Now, you can learn from reading someone else's mail. And you may learn that it was actually meant for you. But all who trust Jesus, not only the immediate people getting this mail in Turkey, present day, but us who believe are exiles. We're not at home. And that is a poignant and powerful reality. Do you feel at home on this earth? You ever drive past somebody who has the not of this world, N-O-T-W, on their car? Are you one of the not of this world people? It comes from John 15. If the world hates you, Jesus said on the night he was leaving them, part of his abide in me, trust in me, wash your feet, serving the Lord's Supper. This precious moment of John that takes up six chapters, part of what he said is, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world. You're not of this world. And see, Peter is qualifying this letter. If you're not of this world, if you're trusting in Jesus, this letter is for you. As it is, you do not belong to the world. I have chosen you out of the world. And this is what Paul says in Romans 1. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. Do we actually believe that? If they persecuted Jesus, did they? They will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they don't know the one who sent me. The rebellion of the world is not about you. It's about God. The enemy of the world is not you or your neighbor. It's the enemy of God. But people hate the one who brings the light because the light exposes their deeds. And you and I have had that feeling, haven't we? No, God, don't. And we've become friends by virtue of what Jesus did for us. And so if we're believing in Christ, we no longer belong to this world and its values and where it's headed. We belong to God. But we get that confused. Why? Because this is where we live. So it's good for Peter to remind us that we're God's elect. Amen. We're safe and secure in Christ. And we're not home yet. So where do you derive your main loyalty and identity? And here's the stake. To really deal with this question, you have to ask, is my main group, is my main identity as a human? Is it as a woman or a man? Is it as a black man, a white man, an American Indian, an Asian Indian? Is it as a Italian from Italy or somebody from New Mexico, which is a whole other country apparently? Where do you get your, is what I do? For many men, it's what we do. Is it the pleasures that define us? Oh, I just living for the weekend or living for the boat ride or whatever. All important, good things, but what? How do they define us? Our memberships? What defines you? Peter is going to nail it right down from the beginning. And beloved, the good thing about days like this is you really got to know who you are and in whom you trust. Is your main identity what Jesus says you are? In Galatians 3, And please hear what this says to your politics. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Amen. What did James 2 say? Right? The same thing. Treat each other that way. We don't say, oh, rich person or poor person first. Do we? And the reality is, we kind of do all of these things. I kind of forget that I'm first. And Peter is reminding us, no, all of our hope, all of our identity is in Jesus. It's in Christ. I'm his new creation. And I mess up my life when I forget that. All my other associations are subordinate. We have political forces right now that want to group you because by grouping you, they control you. Amen? All of them. And the church, this is where we shine. This is our moment. No. You're not black or white to Christ. Amen? You're not rich or poor to Christ. Are those associations subordinate in your life? Are you anything before you're a child of God? Before you met Jesus, you were all of those things. Now that you've met Christ, what are you mostly? And this should be causing conflict in your life. It should be causing conflict. It's good conflict. Race, gender, politics must no longer define you, only Christ. Actively resist all groupings outside of Christ. Okay? We are sent to bear fruit of Jesus. We are Christ ones, Christians. Thus, we don't value things as the world does, and they think us mighty strange, and they think you threatening. In Soviet Russia, they had to get rid of the church. Hitler had to corrupt and get rid of the church. They will always attack the church. This country was born on this idea that there was a creator, and thus the creator holds the rights, not the government. And once you trade that away, someone must be supreme, and it will always be somebody who's declaring themselves the government. Never make that trade. God gives rights. And the first thing he gives is identity. Now, that's still true of the person who doesn't know it yet. And so we can't hate. We love through Christ. But please resist all other identity grouping. And so look, that's three verses. We're moving quick. Three words. To God's elect, exiles scattered among the provinces, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Jesus Christ. Do you hear these clauses? They're important. They're bricks in a beautiful house. You are God's elect. This ain't your home. You're scattered. But you've been chosen according to God's plan. And chosen by the working power of the Holy Spirit, present tense, to be obedient. Do you hear all the time confusion here, tense confusion? It's because everything is now becoming and not yet and yet guaranteed to be. And if you know physics at all, I'm comfortable with that. Because you can't nail it down. You have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit to be obedient in Christ. Chosen by an act of God's will before you deserved it or even understood it to become and become more obedient and like Christ. This process. You've been elected to join a process that is guaranteed to end in this place, but as you walk it out, that's where you're headed. And this happens under the constant encouragement, witness, and pressure of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is this deposit. When the word jumped off the page to you and you said, I need to believe this, the Holy Spirit showed up. And that presence, that decision where you felt, I must decide for Christ, was a ratification of Jesus deciding for you. And once that process starts, it's this presence that is beyond time. And so it's here and not yet. You're growing and becoming and yet guaranteed to become. It's this encouragement and witness and pressure via your decisions to obey.
I hope I'm making this clear. As the Holy Spirit puts his weight on your life, and you begin to hear the voice where you hear the voice of God speak to your inner voice, the voice that right now is evaluating my words. Right now, you have an inner dialogue going on. Amen? I don't like his shirt or yes, I'm following. I get this, right? And somewhere in between, did I leave the oven on? That inner dialogue, the Holy Spirit speaks to that. Amen? And that's what wakes you up. If you're listening to this sermon, I guarantee you six times you'll drift. Right? The Holy Spirit snaps you and you get, right? What's that voice? That's where God speaks to. And it's the constant encouragement there. And when we say yes to that voice, we take another step. So, you know, I always put hell over here and heaven over here, where we are and where we need to be. And so with each little yes, Holy Spirit, we move and we have a testimony and we have an experience. Anytime you obey the Holy Spirit, you have an experience that you can never deny. Amen? And the devil likes to say, what about the time you didn't? And that's an experience you can never deny too, and it's humiliating and it's embarrassing. And yet, Peter's pointing us, no, but let's talk about how we're growing in Christ, because that's who you really are. The minute you decided for Jesus, who decided for you. That's who you are. It's so important to understand who you are in Christ. In 2 Thessalonians, it says this, Paul writing, Paul and Peter, Paul had to yell at Peter, but under the Holy Spirit, they agree. God chose you as first fruits to be saved through the sanctifying work, this processing work, this yes, Spirit work of the Holy Spirit, and through belief in the truth. Because when you say yes to what the Holy Spirit is telling you, you're believing the truth. He called you to this process through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why is this process? Because this process of, yes, Holy Spirit, growing, having a testimony, is the same process of a tree that receives sunlight, soil. Don't give trees oil. Water and oxygen. If the tree's there and it receives those things, it will grow. It will respond. It will renew. And you don't have to tell it to release. Why? Because an apple tree that's growing will make apples. Amen? A cherry tree that you just provide soil, air, water, and sunlight to will produce cherries. And a Christian who listens to the Holy Spirit, and regardless of its bad seasons, regardless of what it fails to do, if it starts to do and agrees to do and says yes to the Spirit, it's going to bear fruit. You're going to bear fruit because that's what you're called to do. And the beauty is, have you ever borne fruit? Not do you always bear fruit. Satan, do you always bear fruit? Jesus, do you ever bear fruit? See the difference? That's encouragement. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory. Man, there's glory around the fruit of Jesus. There's glory, and there's substitute glories. And Lord, help me remember that I am not of this substitute glory world. I'm of this world. So then, stand firm, hold fast to the teachings. That's what 2 Thessalonians says. And so he says, to the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Christ, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood. Here we go. Blood represents life in the Bible. And whenever, like, sin takes life, when Cain killed Abel, in Genesis 4, it says his blood cried out from the ground. Now, I say, you've heard me preach this sentence probably four times in the last 8 weeks. Why? Because in our culture, we are no longer taking seriously sin and justice, real justice. Blood represents life in the Bible and in our bodies. Amen? If you lose blood, you're dead. Blood is how we oxygenate. Blood is how we live as an organism. And sin sheds blood. Cain shed his brother Abel's blood, and God, who made both of them, said, that's wrong. Before Cain killed Abel, God put his arms figuratively around his shoulder and said, you know what's right. You know you failed the offering. Bring it better next time. Instead of listening to God, Cain eliminated his brother who did it right. And it was wrong.
Blood is required to atone for that. What he did, how can it be repaid? If there, true justice would require an eye for an eye. And so God gave us that law. I'm going to jump ahead a little bit and then back. But the blood of sacrificial animals was the sign of the sacrifice to come. So the sacrifice of the lamb that led the people out of the Passover on the 10th plague, that blood that over the doorpost, the angel of the Lord passed over. Anybody who had applied the blood to their doorpost, that's the Passover. People apply the blood in the temple. The priest did that on behalf of the people to point to what Jesus was going to do. The blood of the covenant in Exodus 24, Moses throws blood on the people so that they would agree about God's promise to redeem them. God is going to save them, and Moses throws the blood, and they say, we will obey. That was a covenant. Of course, they didn't obey. But like the garden and like Peter, who said he would do something and didn't do something, God did what they didn't do. In other words, we will obey. No, you won't, but one will for you. Peter, I won't deny you. Yes, you will. But I still will redeem you. I love you. We've got to discover who we are, and who we are is people who are broken down. We can't save ourselves. We need a Savior. And so this is the blood Jesus refers to. When he gives the communion, do not be afraid that this religion was accused of cannibalism. You can see why. It talked about blood a lot. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body. Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he's having a Passover meal, he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant. When we receive, we're literally stepping into that sprinkling of the blood of Jesus. Why? Because we are sinners. And the wages of sin is what? Death. And the way to life is through the death of Christ. In Romans 12, 24, you've come to God, to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. We're going to tie it here together in just a bit. So, the one who by faith believes the promise and applies the offered blood of Jesus to their sin has their sin covered by the work of a priest, Jesus, through the blood of the sacrificial lamb, Jesus, under the authority of the one wronged, God, and is adopted into the family of God and given the status of child of God. Peter is saying, listen, you who count on the blood, you are a child of God, and grace and peace is yours in abundance. Praise, now here we're going to tie it in, same message said differently. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ in his great mercy. Once we use the word mercy, three other words need to prop up. Two other words. In his great mercy, he has given us new life, new birth into a living hope, a present tense hope, a never going to end, a perfect tense hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. Who is he writing to? He's writing to God's elect, aliens, and yet completely His, completely belonging to Jesus Christ. And how do we know it? Because the justice, the mercy, and the grace of God has been satisfied. Let's talk about the word justice. Justice means what the law requires and what a lawbreaker deserves. Think on it. What are the wages of sin according to Romans 6:23? The wages of sin is death. In other words, what's a wage? Something you're paid for working. If you work sin, what do you pay? Death. Do you believe it? God said to Cain, don't work this into your life. It's going to lead to death. Cain said, I don't care. And he killed his brother. And his brother's blood cried out for justice. Avenge me. It was wrong. How do you fix a wrong? You at least have to eye for an eye. If I take your eye, justice is you take my eye. Right? If I kill your cow, if I rent your cow and he dies, I owe you a cow. That's justice, right? It is. It's justice. Does it make you feel better? I don't know, but at least it's just. Maybe I should owe you 10% for the lost cow time. I don't know. But we deserve wrath, and the sick know it. Here's the thing.
I cannot convince somebody that they are as bad as Cain. I can only preach to those who know it. I've really struggled with this. I want you to know that you're as guilty as Cain. Not so that you'll stay there, so that you'll turn to your Redeemer. But the world hates this. It hates this message. It's destroying the church who says things are wrong. Amen? This is all about we want our abortions. We want to live the way we want to live sexually. We want to have it the way we want to have it. And Jesus stands astride history and says, no, it's killing you. And I love you so much that I died for you. And yet the world hates him because he convicts them. Amen? And me, part of me hates Jesus. Do you get that in you? There's a part of you that's phony and fake and full of it. Take that to Jesus. Admit it. That's when you know, man, you've made a few steps as a believer. When you can say, oh, Lord, like Peter, do you love me, Peter? That's why he asked the question 3 times. Because he wanted Peter to just get, you know I love you. And Jesus never said, well, you know, back there, do you love me? He was trying to get out of Peter, you know I do. So that Peter would be reminded, I do. And I love Jesus. But I have this place that I would hide him in a corner if I could get away with my stuff. And I have to say to Jesus, you know I love you. And he says to me, if you love me, come on, leave that behind. And he's offering that to the world. And so anymore, folks, it's time to stand up and offer Jesus in you, how he's working in you. Be as honest as you can. But don't let them make you anything but a follower of Christ. But pure justice demands death for death. Mercy is not getting what we deserve. So let's get 3 words right. Justice is you should get what you deserve. Mercy is not getting that. And grace is getting what we don't deserve. So if I deserve death and I don't get death, that's mercy. But if I get eternal life, that's grace. Now, how can justice and mercy and grace live in the same sentence? How can they be? You took my cow, and if I just forgive you without you giving me a cow, there's no justice, there's mercy. And if you took my cow, and I forgive you, and I give you another cow, that's grace, but there's no justice. How do all 3 happen? A satisfactory redeemer. Amen? And that's the only way. When Peter says there is no name, there is no other way, there is no other truth, the only way a righteous and good God who cares about 6-year-old girls killed in Chicago, and he does, and that blood must be answered. Amen? The blood must be answered. He's just. He sees it. There is a hell. There is a lostness. There is a day of reckoning. There is wrath. Thank God. I am so pleased that God is a God of justice. But I cannot live under his justice, for I too am guilty. And I have not been sent here to point out everybody else's problem before I at least take my broken eye, my eye with a plank in it, to the Lord. But there is one way, a satisfactory redeemer. Jesus dies the death I deserve on that cross. That's why he took human flesh. That's why he had human blood going through him. Why was Jesus born a baby? So he could bleed. He dies the death I deserve and pays to a just God the penalty. And God accepts it. God planned it. From the Passover on, he was saying to his people, I will make a way. And his name is Jesus. And Paul in Acts walked through all these cities saying, it's Jesus is the one God promised. God promised, and he did it, it's Jesus. And they said, no. Some did, some said, yes. The church is that people that says, yes, he did it. And so God accepts this great act of love and sacrifice as a just payment. Jesus' death justifies the believer. The Holy Spirit, that's instant. Done. The minute you believe, you're justified. Penalty has been put on Christ, and you get mercy and grace. Because God not only forgives sin, but he gives you life. And what is that life? It's the Holy Spirit that keeps coming to you and working on you. Amen? This is good news. This is steak. This is a protein smoothie that never ends. These are bad images, but I'm trying. That's why you pray for your pastor. Thus, I get what is due to Jesus. That is amazing. What is coming to Christ is now coming to me. Why? Because I've been adopted through blood. I've been born again. And I have an inheritance. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power, until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. And all this greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer. And that's great news for today. I'm probably healthier in days like this. I'm not as good and reliable. And if times are good, I don't know. I was just made, I think, for the tough times. And maybe you too. I do believe that God has called the church to this moment on purpose. It's part of his plan. And so you and I need to stand up to it with confidence and rejoice. Though we may suffer for a little while, the genuineness of your faith will be revealed in this, which is worth more than gold, worth more than any of those other identities and pleasures. And even though refined by fire, you know, gold gets refined, so do we. So that this will bear fruit, praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you've not seen him, you love him. And see, there's love. How do I know I love him? Because you're in this process, and you listen, and you keep growing, and you trust, and you believe. And even though you don't see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your believing. The salvation of your souls are receiving. It's present. It's happening now. And yet it's this inheritance. I had a dream the other night. I don't dream. I don't talk about dreams. They're not reliable. And I'm telling you, it was a dream. But it was a dream that encouraged me greatly. I was in a car accident. I'm not trying to give any flashbacks to folks who have. This was a dream-style car accident, the kind where you wake up or you have some... I knew it was the first time ever in my life I dreamed this. Here comes a truck, and it's not going to not hit me. And as it hit me, it's like my car went through it, and suddenly I was in the most pleasant place I'd ever been in. And the thought was, Jesus is here. It was instant. I didn't feel the impact. I didn't feel anything. I just immediately knew I was no longer on this world. And I was with him, And the thought that kept going through me was, you did it. You did it. You did it. I think heaven's going to be a lot of, yeah. Yes. Have we seen him? In a way, yes. And in a way, no. Are we there yet? In a way, yes. And in a big way, no. Is the Holy Spirit active in our lives, encouraging us and acting like a promissory note? Yes. But we look through a glass dimly. Amen. Paul said it, so it's okay to say it. We wonder. I don't doubt Jesus, but I don't understand how. I see the process and I believe it. But occasionally God will reach down and he'll remind you that he's going to do it even better than you thought. And though you've not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him. And you're filled with an inexpressible and a glorious joy. Wait until that moment. I believe when people die, Jesus says, in my Father's house are many rooms. I will come and take you to be with me. Whether they plowed into the earth in an airplane accident or whether they died in a hospice bed, Jesus shows up. And I've seen it too many times not to tell you this. Maybe 10 times in my life, I've seen that passage where the person just is gone. The body is left and there's nothing deader, nothing than a dead body in a bed. Sorry. And there's nothing more full of life than seeing that happen. Because there's something in you, there's life in you that God redeems. Amen? That's eternal, that cannot be contained by mass, that has to lose mass to go light speed. I've seen it, and Jesus is going to do it, and it should be filling you with inexpressible and glorious joy. That day is coming. This earth is not our home. Don't get tied up in it. Prophets longed to see how God was going to do this. Let's skip that part. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, and this is where we'll end. Are they? Here's your call today. Peter said, here's who I am. Here's who you are. Now here's what we got to do. Sober up. Whatever's clouding your spiritual thinking, whatever's this misty thing on the horizon, sober up, wake up, which is a funny word in a woke culture. Is your mind clouded by concerns and drunk with other loves? Isn't that how it feels when we succumb to temptation? It's how it feels for me. It feels like I'm drunk. Drunk on me. Whatever persistent sin is in your life, a habit, a bitterness, a fear, a complaining spirit, a lust, a pleasure, a pain, that's part of the sleepy drunkenness. You're not fully alert. You're not fully sober. Reality is we are not often fully alert or sober. This is what you confess to Jesus. Please do the work. Do the work. Find those places. We are headed into a time that the church is going to be attacked and withered, and you have to be ready. It's time to be ready. We should have been ready before. Maybe many of you are. But if you're not, take these words to heart. The goal is to wake up to the reality of justice, mercy, and grace in Jesus. And if you hear the Holy Spirit, why aren't we obeying? And if we are obeying, hallelujah. But most of us are in this sort of middle ground where we can do better. It's not going to make you more saved. It's going to make you more fruitful and more in His will and more a power of redemption in the world, more a worker of grace and mercy. In an age of wokeness, in a drunk culture, full of the blood of politics, mayhem, party spirit, abortion, and a million other things crying out for justice, and they cry out for justice, are you woke to Jesus as your number one thing of value? Your pearl of great price, your deepest allegiance? Is your identity rooted in being a blood-bought child of God? Aware of your sin, knowing your need for mercy and grace, alert to the wiles of the evil one. Set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at His coming. We need to stop here. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, you're present. You're doing your work through your word. You love this people. You're reaching out to those who came today, not even knowing if they believe. But Lord, I sense your Holy Spirit right now is just doing work in hearts. And so I ask, Lord, that it would be met with faith. Yes, Lord. Right now, you're telling somebody this has to go. Yes, Lord. And Father, I pray they would turn to you in prayer today repeatedly. And they'll find out, they'll discover, Lord, I'm so grateful to hear it, because they'll discover that you will redirect them. You will give them strength when they need it. You will remind them, oh, Father, bring obedience. Help them listen. And Father, bless the person right now who wants to believe. Show them that that's the start. That's where it starts. Pray from that part of their heart. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And Father, be with whoever is hearing, listening, encountering this moment. Holy Spirit, do your work. You are the power of redemption. By faith, I pray now people would receive your blood, bought, purchase, and know they belong to you. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. Having worshiped through the word and given, now's the time, I mean, that we give in response. There's so many ways to give now at the church. You can give in the boxes in the back. You can give online. You can give through work, all kind of ways. Just figure out how you want to do that and how you want to support the work. Thank you for your generosity.
This heart that is now yours, you can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world, take this life and breathe on. This heart that is now. Joy I found, surrendering my crowns at the feet of the King, who surrendered everything. Oh, the peace that comes when I'm broken.
Yeah, let's stand. I want to do something. We want to do something fun. And we're going to go back to a Billy Graham meeting here now. And I'm George, not George Beverly Shea, but the other guy. They all live to be 108.
Hope you do too.
What was the choir leader's name? Darn it, I didn't even think I'd forget it.
Do we have our notes?
Yes. We're going to do Nothing But the Blood, but let's do it old style. And I'm going to sing the first part of it, and if you would answer me back. So I'll say, what can wash away my sin?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Sing it.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
For my pardon this I see,
nothing but the blood of
For my cleansing, this my plea.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
You sing it with me now.
This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No
God love you and bless you. May his Holy Spirit continue to encourage you, leading you into this great inheritance that you have by faith in Jesus, bought by his blood, secure forever. Live that life. In Jesus' name, go forth rejoicing. Amen.